Okay, so can you tell us like what was so Nico's job at Nike? Can you just put it in like regular terms of like what did he actually do? What was the regional rep? Explain like what his job was at Nike.
Yeah, so when he started out, which I believe was in the spring of 2002, he was what's called a regional rep, which, you know, I've always joked, sounds like the coolest job ever. Basically got to go to all the games and talk to the players and make sure that they're cool with the shoes they're wearing, make sure they're kind of familiar with all the campaigns going on, that they know the technologies and just, you know, other stuff when, whether it's doing, you know, at that time, maybe you're doing some photo shoots for East Bay Magazine or Finish Line or, you know, Slam Magazine, stuff like that. So obviously more of a print media era at that time, but regional rep, there's pretty much, I think anywhere from 40 to 50 any given season. There's guys that man the West region. There's guys that do the Midwest, like Nico was at the time with the Spurs specifically. He worked with Tim Duncan, Manu, and Tony Parker. And then the following year was when Tim Duncan actually signed with Adidas and left. And then that's when Nike signed Kobe. And so then he went from managing the Spurs guys to then dealing directly with Kobe and basically worked with Kobe throughout his entire rest of his career. So I think the big misconception is that like Nico's like a shoe marketing guy or something like that. And that's not at all what his role is.
Shoe salesman.
Yeah. Like Nate Jones had a funny tweet about like, they're not hiring some shoe salesman, you know?
Not right.
it's a far like, you know, more, I would say player identification role, like kind of strategist role. And also, you know, really getting into the details of landing these contracts and negotiating contracts, which when it comes to free agency is going to be huge for you guys. So, you know, I think that's the thing. It's like, you know, people were asking, what is the shoe guy going to know about the salary cap? I'm like, well, he's been handling crazy budgets for years, managing an entire, this we're talking about a multi-billion dollar, you know, basketball category at Nike across both Nike and Jordan brand. So it's no small task. You know, I think that's the biggest thing is that this is a guy that's very well-versed in the business world. But on top of that, you know, he's very strong in terms of negotiations. I'm sure as you guys know, you know, Nike for the most part pays less than most other brands and they're still able to sign the players they want. So a lot of that comes with the loyalty to the brand, but also the relationships that guys like Nico are able to build with these players. And so there's a great loyalty there. And I think for him, you know, obviously you're looking at the brand signings more from a straight marketing standpoint. Obviously you want the player to play well on the floor as well. And so now his eye and his perspective probably changes to more of the basketball fit that him and Jason Kidd will decide fits best with the roster. But I think for a lot of the similarities of identifying guys, signing contracts, landing guys and building out a roster, I think there's a lot of things that are going to translate directly over. And I think in the article, I kind of joked, like he was basically the GM of Nike basketball. If you want to look at it from that perspective, you know, for the last 10 years. So I think that's probably the best way to look at it.
Salary cap's a little different over at Nike than it is in the NBA.
You're surprised. Like, they got limits on stuff. You know, there's all these different interesting clauses on stuff. I always joke there's actually restricted free agency in sneaker deals, too. So in the NBA, if you sign an offer sheet, you get, you know, 3 days to match for a team. And in the sneaker world, you get 10 business days to match. So if Luka would have signed with Puma, Nike would have had 10 days to match, you know?
Would he have to match it then, or would it just be, like, another offer?
No, so there's great examples where, I actually was going to bring this up, and I think it's an interesting – I don't want to start anything, but it is an interesting dynamic to explore. But, you know, like a great example was Odell Beckham signed an offer sheet with Adidas, and Nike waited till like 4:52 on the last business day and matched it. You know, wow. So there's scenarios like that that come up all the time. Probably the most infamous non-match is you know, Steph Curry, when he signed with Under Armour, and then Nike decided not to use the match clause and let him go. But then in the case, I think this is something that's interesting just because I was just trying to connect all the dots of obviously, you know, Nico's time at Nike and maybe how that translates. And another European guy who had a carryover deal, 1 year left with Nike after his rookie year and then became a shoe free agent, was Kristaps. And he got a 7-year offer sheet from Adidas and Nike declined to match. So, you know, that was an example where maybe that was a marketing fit thing, but, you know, Nike decided not to match on that, let him go to Adidas. So, you know, they do kind of have some, I thought that was kind of an interesting connecting of the dots between,
yeah,
you know, Nico's past role and obviously Kristaps too, but, you know, for whatever reason, but yeah, there's a lot of things in terms of clauses that, I don't really doubt his ability to just pick up and run with the salary cap nuances and be good from there. And obviously there's assistant GMs and other guys in the office that'll be cap gurus in that sense.
I can see the headline now on Moneyball or Smoking Cuban.
That's not what I'm trying to say.
Nico Harrison hates Kristaps Porzingis, didn't match his deal. Nick DePaula is.
No, I was just thinking of like, what were all the Mavs related elements? And obviously, yeah, right.